Hey, welcome to another Money Today from Tirana, Albania. And maybe I'll show you a little clip. I did some drone footage from the hotel I was just staying at, which was absolutely epic. Anyways, I am in a place which is also pretty amazing, overlooking the city. And I'll be in one place for the next month, so it'll be a lot easier for me to make videos for y'all. Because so much is happening right now in the crypto space, it's just almost impossible to keep up. So I'm going to give you some of the news today, which is very important. Actually, tonight I am going to see I'm going to finally see Dune. Many of you probably already have seen it, but there is so much wisdom if you can get to. There's a lot in every book, but the God Emperor of Dune in particular, there's just so many great quotes in that, and the whole theme of it really fantastic for understanding politics and how things work. It's really brilliant. Here's one of the quotes from God Emperor of Dune. Governments can be useful to the governed only so long as inherent tendencies towards tyranny are restrained. I think we all pretty much know that. It's not very deep, but it is a bit topical nonetheless. And if you saw my last video, you understand why I posted this particular one. So let's get on to the news. SDX Global, the digital asset exchange developed by Six Group, which is built on and is R3, which is the banks, which I've showed you that in previous videos, that it is was created by the banks. So now, of course, Six Group to launch before the end of the year, which is basically the big digital bank, which is going to be the Swiss digital bank. Now, this is posted by Council of Quamp. And in the next one, here's what made me actually look deeper into this. SDX Go Live event, and then it has a 10 November 2021. And HyperQuamp here says SDX, which is the new digital asset exchange, Six Group. Okay, I'm okay with that. $3 trillion market cap, okay, maybe not, goes live on November 10th. Now, this is the part that didn't make any sense to me, and I've been questioning it, and nobody has given me an answer. In fact, these people are, I got a reply from HyperQuamfy saying, oh, I've shown you so many times, but that's totally not true. And if you look at this, it says 10 period November 2021. So either somebody made this up or it is the 10th slide and it's just about November 21. So I think this might happen this month. I don't think it's going to happen on November 10th, which is my birthday. It would be great, but I don't know about that. And to be honest, I've never seen an actual confirmed link between Quant and SDX. Or Quant and R3. I've seen lots of things that are, you know, kind of show you that they may be working together or that it would fit or it would make a lot of sense. And they are working in a lot of the same areas, doing a lot of the same things. So it would make sense. I hold Quant. That would be great. But I just wanted to put that little caveat in there. I have not seen any direct evidence coming from either Quant or from SDX saying they will be working together, like we have with, you know, a lot of the other things that we mentioned. So I think it's very important. Now, this from Quant, though. Join our CEO, Gilbert Verdian, on a panel at the first Digital Pound Foundation webinar taking place on November 10. Well, that is happening. Speaking alongside Ripple, GCI Global, Electronium, Avalanche, and Bank of England, and more. So, hey, this is pretty big and pretty bullish for Quant. Also, I mean, like I tell you, there's so much happening. I'm just giving you a little bit. Looky here, David Treat posted by R3. So David Treat, who isn't really part of R3 as far as I know, but you know the big three are Hyperledger, which is the Linux Foundation, R3. Which is the banks, and Enterprise Ethereum Alliance, which is JP Morgan, Microsoft, you know, Deloitte, this thing. Between the three of them, it's pretty much everything in the entire cryptoverse, which could be the entire metaverse. I really, really, really believe there is no way that the metaverse is going to happen without it going through one of these three or all of these three. And say what you will for XRP, which I'm not saying, you know, I'm such a big fan of King Solomon, and, you know, I think that Ripple and maybe XRP, but certainly Ripple has a huge part to play in all of this. But even that one, it's all going to go through the three, R3, Hyperledger, Linux Foundation, and Enterprise Ethereum Alliance. This is just why I'm seeing it. So this is David Treat, who is from Accenture, which we see all the time. Enterprise Ethereum Alliance, Hyperledger, Chamber of Digital Commerce, ID 2020, World Economic Forum, and, of course, the Digital Dollar Project. I mean, this is literally the most connected person that I have ever seen in all of my research, like by far, because he's literally connected to all of them except R3, and now R3 is retweeting this guy. So something is up with David Treat, I'm telling you. And so if you kind of follow what he's doing, I think you're going to be right on the trail of what's going on. Now, he may head fake you at some point, but I'm telling you. So listen to what he's saying here about the metaverse.
And then all of this wrapping together, as I said earlier, into digital asset markets as maybe, again, that I would offer from our community's perspective, this is the backbone for what the effective metaverse will need or what the metaverse will need to be effective and reach scale. The variety and the rethink that has to happen of what marketplaces are, we're working on the fundamental building blocks of those marketplaces. The creativity that's going to get unlocked is amazing, right? So today we talk about B2C, B2B, and even the already varied experiences of how do we interact and bring buyers and sellers together around product and price. The whole notion of the product as marketplace, as an example of some of the what's possible ahead of us, that ability to take your phone, hover over an object, have that object actually then be able to sell, provide a link to another one of those objects, and to be able to buy it and have the physical item show up, or have the digital object, purchased and delivered to you in the digital world. The creativity that's coming around digital asset markets, again, all underpinned by the building blocks that we're creating around digital currency, digital identity, and digital supply chain.
I think as far as the banks and the big corporations are concerned, this is their plan, because this is the guy who's connected to all of them. Now, if you watched the last episode, you saw G. Edward Griffin, and I have followed his work for a long time on many different subjects, and he's been pretty darn accurate about everything. So he came on Stansberry Research and kind of gave us an update on what he sees happening and how it's going along. And I thought that was a pretty good thing to bring to you guys. So listen to this for a sec.
The banks are pretty much in control now, and they're very confident that they will maintain control well into the future. If we follow that scenario, then it's easy to see what we're headed toward, and it's not a pretty picture at all. I think anybody's wildest nightmare would be pretty close to that. I mean, we're looking at a world, at best, we're looking at a world that would be like everybody being in the military. In other words, you have everything provided for you. You have your health care, your clothing, your food, your shelter, everything you need. Provided you follow the rules. And if you step out of line, well, you're in the brig. And if you really step out of the line, you're lined up against the wall and shot. So that's, you know, and we all have rank then. There are the generals, and then there are the sergeants and the buck privates and all of that sort of thing. And you wear uniforms and you recognize each other by sight as to what your rank is. And the whole system depends on authority. That's where we're headed, at best. Now, it could be even worse than that, but that would be the basic system as I see where we're headed.
Are you optimistic with with movements such as what we've seen with Bitcoin, the popularity of Bitcoin, of the new generation who wants a decentralized system. Are you optimistic that that day would come where we wouldn't need a central bank, where people would understand this?
Well, I am cautiously optimistic, and I put that word there because I understand that to a large extent, many of the people who are so enthusiastic and rightfully enthusiastic about cryptocurrencies are motivated by the idea of a decentralized system and lack of control by both governments and banks. But I also recognize that the larger is that, hey, I want to get in on the profits. Most people would philosophically say, yes, oh, it's a good idea. I wish we could get rid of this control. But when it comes to parting with money and investing in something, that's a different story. Most people, and this is true, most people who are actually buying cryptocurrencies today are not buying them because they're expecting to use them as a currency of exchange, but because they want to make a profit. They said, I don't want to miss out on this. And there's nothing wrong with that, by the way. But I'm saying that the focus really, if they didn't think that it was a chance to make some big money, I don't think most people would be in the cryptocurrency market right now. And that's just it's a natural fact. In fact, myself, I say that myself. I have bought some crypto because I don't want to miss out either.
And the link will be in the description so you can listen to the whole thing. I certainly would. One of my biggest problems with, say, Ron Paul, you know, it's hard to kill your heroes. But he's always talking about, like, we're broke and that we need to repay the national debt, which if you really, really understand how the Fed works, then you realize that it's impossible to pay back the national debt because it's all debt to begin with. And there's just, if you paid back all of the debt, there would be no money. And that means that anybody telling you that we need to repay the national debt, I'm sorry, they're just lying to you. And so it's very hard for me to put two and two together there with Dr. Ron Paul, who I've been a big fan of for a very long time. But hey, I got to point out the obvious. If you see it differently, please leave it in the description. Let me know where I've missed this. Last but not least, we've talked a lot about Oasis. And it's still one of those things where I think it would be not a bad idea to hold on to. But not financial advice, of course. We strive to build a better internet for everyone, which is why we're thrilled to announce the launch of MetaMirror and MetaBuddy, MBuddy? At Auth3 Network, offering the first Web3 identity service that puts the power of your social media data into your own hands. Sorry if I sound cynical there. Having known what the Oasis Foundation is, which you can go back to my video and look, same old people, same old thing going on, in my opinion. But it is something to keep an eye on because we know digital identity is so important for them to accomplish all of this. It has to be done. Everybody in the entire world needs a digital ID for this to work for them. So who is it going to be on? I mean, I can almost guarantee it's going to be Enterprise Ethereum Alliance, Linux Foundation, R3, or all three. But will there be a third party that gets involved there that it goes through one of those three? And I think that if you watch my video on Oasis Foundation, you will likely figure out where it's going to go. So I will look closer into this because I think I don't know anything about MetaMirror and MBuddy and Auth3 Network. So it's something, I think we need to pay attention. So appreciate you going through this with me. I think all of this is such important information. Share it, subscribe if you're not, most of you are, and pass this around and just start talking about it. Let's figure this out together. All right, see you in the next one. Love y'all.